much, 93, for inviting me to be one of your speaker. I heard several anecdotes before I came over that most of you came here not because of me, but because of Sean. They wanted to see Sean in person. Is that true? Jimmy, is that true? I also heard only about half or less than half are from Xavier here tonight, having your children at least go to an OJT or internship. At that time, hindi pa tinatawag yung OJT. There was no such word. What I did was on my own, probably because of the values that I think I had to do something during the summer. And I went into a boutique investment house called Multinational Investment Bank Corporation. And I know it's an investment house, they assigned me to the equities desk. And that's how I got into. So when I applied after graduation in 1975, there were two schools. I entered there, a newbie, probably was just a few weeks, a few months. And somebody told me that a friend I thought who I trusted told me, oh, you better invest in this company. So I put in some. I didn't know that what brokers were buying. It looks very, very decisive when they're buying. So the stock from 2 centavos went to 4 centavos. There was a price freeze at the time. You know, when you're 2, 4, double your, it's at 100% the freeze. The next day, from 4, it went to 8. Another freeze. By the weekend, the stock exchange was asked to remove the freeze. Over the weekend, there was an announcement that we have, for the first time in the Philippines, we have the oil fine in the Philippines. And so there was a pandemonium. The stock went up from 8 centavos all the way to 29 centavos. At that time, it's not computerized at that time. You have to walk up to the board. And by the time, so everybody's order was market order. So you go up to the board, and by the time the trader goes up there, the price was either buyers at 16 instead of 29, you just have to buy. So why 29? Of course, I wasn't able to sell at 29, but the buyers that bought a lot, pushing it up to 29, the brokers started selling. So again, just being what is, look at what's happening also, maybe look at the fundamentals, but look at what the flows, look at what's happening. So what's the lesson there? Of course, luck plays a role. No, it's not all brains, luck plays a role, but better do your homework and look at what's happening in the market. No? Okay, what's my next investment? I'm sorry, but is it okay if I do some examples? Looks like you're quiet. So when you start making noise, okay, the next thing, major investment that I had was PLDT. You know, the market was really down in 1986. You remember the Edsa Revolution?
Yeah.
People, I don't know, I think you're too young here. You remember the 1986 Edsa Revolution? People were in the streets in Edsa. Actually, I was there also, but I wasn't worried about whether there would be bloodshed or not. I was worried about my position in the U.S. because I was short PLDT. And I'm supposed to deliver, and my broker in New York, Mary Lynch, asked me, you have to deliver. There's no, you cannot buy back, and you cannot buy because you're supposed to deliver. I said, what? That's a bad word, okay. how can I deliver? It's force majeure. The market here is closed. there's black, you know, this revolution going on. How can you allow me to? How can you do that? Not allow me. So they actually allowed me to buy back and go long. So it was at 30 pesos. And on opening, when after the revolt, and the opening, first opening day, the stock from 30 went up to probably 50, 60. But on the other hand, the price in the New York was already actually probably $2, $3. You know, one thing that you should watch for is that investors actually very, very smart. At $2, they were willing to buy and was pushing it up already $2.50, $3 with a possible bloodshed, and the outcome was actually a big probability there's going to be bloodshed in the country. But they were buying, was treated it like as an option. That they can buy a company for $1, $2, but if the president, the government was toppled, you should probably see that the stock move up about double or triple, which is exactly what happened. Now, at 30, whether it was already 70 or 80 bucks, I was telling my friends in the stock exchange, you know, my co-brokers, that this one stock that's gonna go to 1,000. I don't know if he's not here, no, but anyway, it's gonna be embarrassed if I name him. He told me actually not to name him. But like I said, I'm gonna use this as an example of, please don't know me, don't name me because I look so stupid. But he said, I told him that it's one stock that's gonna go to 1,000 because at that time, PLDT was trading at, maybe let's assume that's 100 bucks or 80 bucks. It was trading about 3x multiple. It was 3x P. For those earnings, anyway, I won't go to that. It's going to bore you. But the equivalent stocks that were listed in New York, like Telefonica or Telmex, Telefonos de Chile, were all trading at 16x multiple. So, if you compute that for PLDT to go to the same level, that would probably be, if you let's say assume you got, don't be proud. As I said, I told Miguel one of the is pride is cheap. Welcome fried chicken, and know when to cut your ear. No, admit your mistake. Be humble, and it's a mistake, and you cut your losses.
Hi, good evening. I have two questions actually. The first one is, when will you write the prequel to your book, the juicier version, where you will be sharing with us controversial stories behind BW and similar situations? And okay, answer that first.
Well, I gave you the story in the interview, right? Most of it was verbally, I'm still deliberating whether I'll do it, which is quite touchy. It's more juicy, but it's the story of the stock market probably in the 70s and 80s, which many do not know about. I'm still thinking about it, whether I should or not. Probably you'll be one of my advisors. Can you tell me?
Let's do a fiction instead.
I think about it.
Okay, the second question is, if you were to give just one investment advice to your grandchildren, what would it be?
You said to your grandfather.
Well, ask the grandchildren to go look up your blog instead, Rose. So Rose is the FQ mom.
Thank you, Rose, for being a part of the ad. She was the first ad that used her to feature this talk about this event.
I got pressured to write a blurb. Cesar mainly goes, you have to write a blurb.
That's why I thought people were coming here for you and Sean, not for
my
you.
My dad thought she was Kim Chu. No wonder he's here.
They wanted women though, mas attractive though. Bakit puro lalaki lang though?
Hi, my name is Enrique. I work for Deutsche Regis. Let's have one question because every week I always look forward to reading the Phil Equity Corner. So I wanted to ask you, Sir Wilson, what cool columnists or which authors do you read that you would recommend other people to read about the Philippine market or global market?
To tell you the truth, you know what's happening to me, and sometimes I voice this out to my friends, also to my colleagues. We have this group, and they tell me about books that they've read. And I said, you know, I still have about 16,000 emails that I haven't read. And, you know, I'm just worried about what I read and mostly research coming from mostly other houses like Goldman Sachs, Deutsche, Credit Suisse, Morgan Stanley, and that's what keeps up my time. I'm not, you know, sometimes I lose out. My friends, they tell me about this Netflix. I'm losing so much in my life. But, you know, it's something that I enjoy. I have to lose some, win some, that I'm not able to, unlike before when I'm able to read. Most of the time I'm reading mostly research materials from houses. Thank you.
I guarantee you will lose more of your life if you get